Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us continue to pray for the refugees who by thousand enter Europe, take a refuge in share in a sure place to protect their families. Let us pray for justice and peace. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and the hour of our death. Amen. Mary, Seat of Wisdom,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So today we begin to study the internal senses. And I divide the chapter in two parts. This morning we study the coordinating sense and imagination. In next class we will study memory and estimative, cogitative, or the instinct for animal. So the internal sense or inner powers. Huh? So when we saw last class, then every senses has a specific object, specific, for example, color for eye, smell, odor for smelling, taste, sweet, etc. So every sense, but those senses cannot communicate with other. So they need to be coordinated. And that we suppose, because for example, you see an orange, I saw that, we see. You smell, and you touch, and you taste. All that together, you can see that is an orange. But it is not your eyes that see to your ear that is an orange. You have to put that together and to arrive to the form of an orange. In that form, it is printed in our imagination. You remember that? It is the sensible impress species. So the form, the similitude of everything here are united in one. So I can say that is orange. I don't say only the color of the orange. No, I say an orange. So that is the we'll speak about that sense now. Why those different sensations are united? Our sensory powers are related. How my eyes is related with my end. So there must be something in common, coordinating. What is the way in which the various sensory powers are interrelated? And that way is the, we call the coordinating sense. In Latin, they call that, St. Thomas called that sensus communis. Common sense. But common sense in English has another meaning. Common sense to be balanced. But so it's better to use the terminology proposed by Father Eichmann, coordinating sense. But if you read the book and they speak about common sense, think about that. Common sense is the coordinating sense. Well, this sense is important. Why? It provides a flexibility and a manifold activity that imply the senses object. In fact, when you see, when you smell, you have many, many activities. And all those activities are unified. That is the problem of the Greek. I told that many times. The Greek was struck by the problem of the one and the multiple, the many. We have many sensations, my eyes, my ear, and all that is I. I see, I listen, I taste, So there must be a sense unifying that. So it is of greater freedom and independence from its environment. So when we are able to take things from the environment and to put that in our mind, we arrive to a certain detachment from the environment. That means we are not attached totally to the environment. You are not the slave of the environment. You can take the environment and put that in our mind, and after that use it for other things, you know? You know? For example, you see a horse. Huh? Well, our ancestors, when they saw a horse, finally they put all what they know about the horse, and they were able, because they have the image and after that the idea of a horse, to be able to control the horse, you know, to have a certain independence from the horse. In fact, when we know something, we become, at the same time dependent on the thing, at the same time you are independent of the thing. For example, you know what is an apple, okay? Well, the apple comes to you in your mind, in your imagination. So you are linked with the apple as an object. But when you have the image of the apple, and we assume the idea of the apple, you can have a certain independence on the apple, a certain dominion on the apple, and you can cut it, you can cook it, you can eat it, etc. You know, you can make pie with that. That means that our central sense, coordinating sense, help us to have a control on the environment. Not only we depend on the environment to know, we saw that, subject, act, object, we depend on the environment, but after that we have the environment entering my mind, I can have a control on it. It's the way the man changed the reality, no? We see a tree, we see wood. After that, we can transform the wood into many things. So we need to be able to take from the thing outside of us what is useful to me, what is necessary for my survival. In fact, our senses, external senses, and coordinating senses are necessary for our survival. We cannot survive if we don't have that capacity of unifying our sense. For example, suppose you see a danger, you see a snake, you know? Well, your seeing must be linked with to touch it, you know? You see an apple, then your seeing is linked with your tasting and your touching. And we need that to survive, because we need to take the environment to survive. We have to eat, no? You have to sleep, you have to build a house to protect against snow, ice, storm, etc. So the role of this, they are very important. Our external senses and internal senses are important. Even for cats and dogs and squirrel. The squirrel has a control about on nuts, peanuts, etc. He has a control because he received the sensation and can use that for its survival. In fact, our senses are given to us for our survival. All animals have that. All animals. You touch a snake, immediately the snake will protect itself, it will attack you. No? So that is a vital necessity for sensory knowledge. We cannot live. So imagine you are blind. You are deaf. You are mute like Helen Keller. She was totally dependent of his father, his mother before. Totally dependent. Imagine. And my sister-in-law lost her eyes, her sight. And now she is dependent on my brother more than before. My brother now is obliged to take care of his wife more than before because she is blind. So when she wants to walk, when she wants to take something or to eat at table, he must help her to touch the glass, not to you know. So we are, our senses, external and internal, are necessary for our survival. And we should not despise our body. Sometimes there is a spirituality that despise the body. They say the body is not good. No, the body is good. It is through the body that we go to God, no? We know God through we saw that through analogy to our senses. Huh? So our external senses are linked with their proper object, and they are unified by the coordinating sense. Okay? So it is, you can read that on the first page. The sensation is an essential dimension of the organism. An animal is incapable of surviving if there is no sensation. So that is primordial. We should thank God for that. You know, I received a slideshow, and it was about the teacher asked the student, what are the seven marvels of the world? And the little girl says, the seven marvels of the world are first the sight, hearing, smelling, touching. It's true. If we are not at the five senses, if we are not imagination, memory, or internal senses, we are condemned to die. So, in short, the development and survival, of living beings are directly dependent upon their ability to make sensitive contact with the world that's around them. In fact, a child knows more and more things through experiencing, through his senses. Is the reason why it's important for children to check if their eyes see well. Sometimes children have difficulty in class because they don't see well or they don't hear well. So they seem to be stupid, but in fact they are not stupid, but they have a problem with their eyes or their ear. Okay. So they cannot attain the world in the same way that the other who have good eyes, good sight, and good hearing. Okay. So we depend on our surrounding to survive. We depend on nature around us to survive. We depend on the ground to cultivate. We depend on the air. We depend on a lot of things, on rain. Okay? So we can see that our senses are the royal gates to knowledge. Our knowledge passes through our senses. That is the teaching of Aristotle, I agree 100% with that. Because through experience, we see those who don't have sight, how difficult to do for them to know color and size. Okay, they would know sight by touching, but they cannot see size only through their eyes. Okay. Next page. Now, the differentiation and coordination of various sensory acts. So how they are related? It is first important that all my senses be unified. If I receive a lot of information, I cannot put them together. It's of no use. So when I receive many information through my senses, I put that together, I arrive to have a synthesis of that, an image, a sensible impressed species, and there I can use it. I can use it for the future. I can organize my life because I know, we know from the known to the unknown, from what I know to my senses, and after that we study imagination, go to my imagination, if this is what we study in a few minutes. So, that sense is coordinating, is unifying, is organizing also. It is when you coordinate, coordinate, that means you have the verb order, to put in order with, to put many things in the same order. That is the role of our coordinating sense. You know, sometimes people know many things, but they have difficulty to put that together. I remember I have a woman, an old woman, she was chiropractor, the first chiropractor, French Canada. And she was taking care of the sister living in Gloucester because they were not able to go out. She went to take care of them. And she told me that one of the examinations she had as a chiropractor, it was to put together the bones of a skeleton. So they told me they gave her a lot of bones. Some bones from maybe cats or dog or cows, and bones from men. She has to find the bones from men and to recreate a skeleton. But it is a little bit what we do with our coordinating sense. We receive a lot of information and we put that in a way that is coordinated, organized. Well, for example, when you look at the orange, okay? You see the orange, but at the same time you can see other things also, no? You can see the truck passing on the street, or you can listen to the ambulance passing, a firefighter. You can feel that it's cold, but you make a kind of, you know, you coordinate the sensation related to the orange. So that is the role of the coordinating sense. We have many, many, many sensations, but we have to put that on one object, one common object. And that common object is the shape, is the size of the thing, is the motion of the thing. When you see a bus passing in front of you, you see not only the size, you see the motion, and you see that through many senses. So what makes you unify all those sensations, hear, look, smell the gas of the, all that, it is the coordinating sense. So I go to number four. In everything we distinguish material object and formal object. Well, here I come back to matter and form. That division of material object and formal object is inspired by Aristotle, no? So you remember when you look at the desk here. The desk is made with wood. So wood is the material object. But it is the same thing, a desk and a pulpit here, or the piano. No. Why? Because there is a form, an idea. The idea put into the wood by the carpenter, we call that the form, the formal object. So when I look at the desk here, when you look at the desk, you see matter, but at the same time, you see the form, material, the form, physical form, and through your intellect, of course, you arrive to more than that. You arrive to the intellectual form. That means in everything, we distinguish matter and form. It is so true that when you study theology, you will study the sacrament, the seventh sacrament, every sacrament has a form and a matter. Baptism, the matter is water, the form are the words. You know, the Eucharist, bread and wine, matter, and the form of the consecration. Okay? So that is material and formal. So what is the material object of the coordinating sense? And what the coordinating sense attain as matter? The impression of all of the spatial senses. He receives the totality of the whole senses. That is the matter of material object. Okay? And the formal object, it is the impression given by the external senses in as much as they are related one to the other. Not only my coordinating sense knows the object in its coming, but he knows the relation between those things. That means my sensations are related in such a way they give me one object. The color of the orange the mess, the order, the orange, all that is one object. Yeah? That is the formal aspect of the material science. And distinction. You can see relation and distinction. My coordinating sense see that my, you know, what I smell and what I touch and what I taste is the same thing, you know. They are related together, but at the same time, they are not the same. The color and the smell and the taste are not the same. So I distinguish the different aspect of the thing, but at the same time, I put them together. In fact, here I come back to one of the idea of Jacques Maritain, to distinguish in order to unite. Relation. I can meet them because I distinguish them. If I don't distinguish the sound from the color, I cannot put it in a relation. So I distinguish and I put them into a relation. That is the function of the coordinating sense. And if you go to next page, so the spatial function is a function, is Father Reichman, of monitoring. Moni. Monas, what is that? Monas. Monopoly. Mono.
One.
So that means to put in one, a monitoring of the activities of the sensor. What is a monitor? A monitor, when there are many children in the park and are playing, and he is monitoring them, I mean he is organizing them. He is unifying the sport. And not, you have to follow the rule of football, to follow the rules of soccer, you know, the rule of basketball. We cannot, so there is a monitor, there is a referee, there is an organizer, to organize. So monitoring, or if you want, organizing, you know, in such a way that the raw data given by each sense, be organized and patterned. What is the word pattern? A pattern is a model. A model. A pattern. You know, when they want to make many sweater the same way with the sign of the Holy Apostle College, for example. So they make a pattern, a model. And when the model is done, they multiply it, you know. So that is the way. We arrive to a kind of a model. For example, from many sensations, we arrive to the sensation of an orange. An orange is not an apple, you know. But there is a model. We arrive to an organized knowledge. If an organized knowledge give me a model, give me a type. Give me a special thing. So that is important because from those special things, like apple, different from radish, different from tomato, in the future I will be able to have the concept of apple, the concept of tomato, you know. What gave me that to my mind? It is my senses. Because we see soon that from my first sensible impress species, I will express that to myself, to have an image, a fantasy about that. So the role of the organizing sense, common sense, coordinating sense is important. But we don't speak about it very much. We speak much more about two others, the imagination, and the memory. Coordinating sense, we don't speak about that a lot. But it is important. It is important. I got number 5.2. The activity of the coordinating sense permits the sensing organism to be aware of the manner in which these sensory activities are related. And that it is able to know that what it sees is also what is sensed. What it sees, it is also what it smells, what it tastes, all that is one. All that is one. So I can know an object through many senses, and I'll be aware that it's only one object because I have the coordinating sense. Otherwise, I will have many sensations without any link. So that is a unified power, unifying power put together. Okay. What we see after that is very important. In fact, number 5.3, this differentiating and coordinating function is very important. This function is irreplaceable to the sensing subject. That means we cannot have a real sense, a common sensation without that, because our senses are continually receiving sensory process. As long as we are awakened, we receive object. We have sensation. Even when you don't think about that, even when you sleep, you have sensation. And some sensations are so strong they make they awake you. For example, suppose during the night the weather comes very cold, and you are sleeping only with your sheet, and suddenly what you feel, the sensation of cold will make you awake, or some noise, or some light is the reason why you have it, a light to inform you. A few years ago, we have an accident on the street here on the highway, Highway 99, and one pipe, gas pipe, was broken, so the gas was expanding everywhere, and it was entering even the seminary. And during the night, the fire came, and they put the alarm, and the light waking me. I was sleeping, but I was receiving sensation, and I smell gas. And we are obliged to leave because all that area are covered with gas. So continually, 24 hours a day. My senses are receiving sensation. I am not aware of everyone, of course, happily, otherwise you will not be able to study. But we receive sensation. And so it is a complex reality. We receive sensation through noise, our ear, smelling other, through our eye, the light, and through that you arrive to unify that. And because of that, I was able to go out of my room and to go out of the St. Philip, because it was like a bomb. The gas was entering everywhere. Okay. So the sense and its function is to put together in order to unify what is multiple. So it is here, from the multiple, from the many, to the one, from the many to the one. But we will see in the future why we can do that, why my coordinating sense is able to do that. For the moment, I stop here, okay? In fact, we will see that it is our human soul, But for the moment, we know that our coordinating sense is making us know, passing us from the many, many sensation to one sense. One common sense, a common object of sensation. Our senses, internal senses and external senses, are always working. And when we are awakened, they are working with our intellect. We cannot separate our sensation from our intellect. Here I smell gas. Oh, come, my nose will not say it is gas. But my intellect will say, hey, be careful, that is gas. Go out as soon as possible. You can explode. Imagine somebody took a match. Our senses work with the supervision of the intellect. We can see that the intellect is an episcop. You know what is an episcop? Episcop. Scop in Greek means to see, a AP above. we see above. Watch. There is a word coming that episcopal. Huh? What is an episcopal? Episcopal. Bishop. A bishop. The bishop is the one who is watching. That's the meaning, yeah? So the watching, the one who is episcoping, looking at. So my intellect, it is my episcop. I say my intellect is my bishop. is over, is controlling, is able to take my sensation and judge, make a judgment about that. So I control. Next page, now we go to imagination. So, imagination is something we use a lot, no? If I say to you, when I am in the refectory, I need a spoon. Can you take for me a spoon? You must have not only the idea of spoon, you have must the image of spoon. And when you arrive, you have forks, you have knives, you have a little a spoon, you have to find. So that means when we think, not only we think, but we think using our imagination. So our imagination is very, very important. All our concepts are linked with imagination, with images. And we will see that when we study intellection in 2 weeks. When we study that, we realize the extreme importance of imagination. Okay, so we can see that imagination is at the center of sense knowledge. So we saw that we have an object and an apple, and our senses are working, they are sending their sensation to the coordinating sense, but that ear is the impress, sensible, you remember? Sensible.
Impress species.
That means it is what? Image. But the image that is impressed on you, when you see, when you have the coordinating image, a sense, you know? The coordinating sense provoke an image. That image now, does not stay in the coordinating sense. Huh? That image will stay in the imagination. So imagination, the first function, imagination, it is to keep, to store, and to store and to keep images. It is the store of our images.
What is the difference between the imagination and form? What is the difference between image and form?
Okay, the image is a form. The image is a form. Because it is what we receive from. That image, that form, can be sensible or can be in universal concept, you know. Both are form. And you remember I told you there is only two formal sign. Formal sign, that means the form as a sign. The sign is only to indicate, and the first is the image. Imagination, image. Imagination is the power to produce image from sensation. To store image, to keep image, and to reproduce them. But the first is the storage of images. The retention of sensory image and is an obvious dimension of the human experience. Once acquired in the coordinating sense, the pattern image, the model and the pattern image made by the coordinating sense, is not lost, but is stored, in the imagination. It is impressed in the imagination. It is printed in your imagination. For example, I was 4 years old. I went to my uncle's farm, and my uncle had a dog, black dog. It's funny, all my dogs are black. It is a sign of my future vocation. Black dog. Its name was Poppy. Poppy, a very kind dog. He will not kill a mouse. He was too kind for that. So, Poppy, I see him. I see that dog. I see him. I have the image of that dog here. That is imagination, you know. I kept for almost 70, 72, 73 years the image of Poppy. Poppy is it. I see the barn, I see my uncle. That is imagination. Imagination store. There you say, Father, that is memory. No. Memory, it is when that image is situated in time. For example, if I say, you know, Poppy, when I saw him, when the first time I came to my uncle's house farm, I see him, he was running, he was waking his tail. That is memory. You know? I link that with a past event. But when I have only the image of a thing independently, that is imagination. Of course, imagination and memory are linked, of course. But I must have imagination. You know, from, yes, brother.
Father, can the coordination between the internal sensor and sensory image?
In fact, the image is the fruit. And the image is the fruit of the action of the coordinating sense. The coordinating sense gives everything to the image, the imagination. Huh? Yeah. But the coordinating sense does not keep the image. It's only forming the image. It forms the image, and the imagination takes that, you know. To take an example of that, you are in the time we printed with letters, you know. So they put all those letters together, pictures together, and when it is ready, the press can put the first impression. You know? So it is, if you want, the coordinating sense is preparing the image. It's furnishing all the elements to have an image. But it is not his role. The role of the formation of the image is the imagination. Okay? But they work together. Huh? They work together. Okay? But the specific or coordinating sense is not the same as the imagination.
Okay? Imagination work even though when out of my at rest or in sleeping.
Yes. Approve of that. Your imagination works even when you sleep. Dreams.
So, because of the first, when you at the beginning discuss, you say that the coordination sense work very relative with the outer senses,
yeah.
And imagination have really function as well with the outer senses, but when our dream. Something happened very long time yeah. ago, but appear now dream. We don't have that time our mind's unconsciousness about that event.
Yeah, yeah.
Happened very long time.
Yeah.
But
you know, I spoke about my dog of my uncle Poppy. This morning it was in my unconscious.
Yes.
In my subconscious, not unconscious. Subconscious.
Subconscious.
So it is easy to think about that. Suppose I see a black dog. With that black dog, that is like Poppy, you know. But my the majority of my images are not conscious. If all your ages were conscious, will you be able to listen to me now? To read, to study? So it is, we have to put, all those are hidden in our subconscious, in our imagination, storing. And when there is a necessity, we take the image, like in the library. You don't take all the books at the time, you take one book. Okay? So the, I go to the text here. Are stored and where they can be combined with others and utilized in various ways. So we can, that is the problem, we see the second function of the memory is not only to store, to keep, it is the, to reorganize, to fiction also, create something new. So this image of the storage of images is what we refer to as sensory experience, but this experience is always enlivened and transformed by an accompanying intellectual awareness. So, we don't have pure sensation. It is impossible for us as human beings, when we are awakened, to have pure sensation. Our sensations are always accompanied with our intellect, with our reason. Every sensation you have, your reason is functioning. Your intellect is functioning. You cannot separate that. But we distinguish now to understand one by one the part. But be aware of that. When you have an image of puppy, at the same time I know that I have the image of puppy. It's not only my pure imagination, it is my imagination with my mind. And that is the difference between those who take LSD. LSD is a drug, a chemical drug in the 16. So the people lost the control of their mind, but they use a powerful imagination. And they create a thing absolutely inimaginable, because when we are awakened, we cannot think about that. Okay, but I will come on that in the future. So I spoke to you, the necessity of retention of image, but that is not memory. The distinction, memory is always linked. The image is linked with the past as past, the past as past. And also the image can be used for the future. And that is the senses we study next week, estimative or cogitative, preparing the future. For animal, it is the instinct, etymology, Well, image, it means a likeness. We have many words. We say image, but we can say likeness, which can say similitude, representation. What is the word representation? Is to make again a present, to make present. When I think, I imagine the dog of my uncle, Poppy. I make it present now. 70 years after, I see Poppy. That is the power of imagination. You have the power now to see the house of your grandfather. You have the power to see the school where you study. You have the power to represent your mother. No? You do that because you have the image of your mother, of your house, of your school, all that stay in you. But when I say to you, represent the church of your parish, now you think about the church because I invite you to do that. But you have the power to do that because they are stored in your imagination. And I will give you a fact that explains that very clearly. The power of storing imagination, images. We have a lot of sensation we are not aware because we don't pay attention to that. For example, at the moment I speak to you, the air conditioner is functioning.
Cool.
It's functioning. That means to listen to the air conditioner, you must stop, listen to me, listen to that. So we have a lot of sensations, but we don't pay attention to each one. And those sensations, that answer your question, come in my subconscious. About 20 years, 30 years ago, there was a hijack. A Palestinian hijacked Air France, a plane from Air France in between Tel Aviv and Paris, the hijack. And the plane was directed to NTB. There is a movie about that. NTB. In Uganda. NTB. And NTB, when they were there, the terrorists liberated all those who were not Israelite. The other, they were free. So among them, there was a doctor, a French doctor, physician. He lived in Paris. So he went back to Paris. And the Jews, the Israelite, they created, they built the airport of NTB 10 years before. So they said, we know, we have all the plan of the airport, but we don't know if something was changed. Maybe they changed the door, they blocked the door, you know. It was important because they prepared an attack against the terrorists. So what did they do? They called the doctor from Tel Aviv. They called. They say, do you accept that we anoptize you in order to have information about the airport of NTB? And the doctor accepted. So they went by a special plane to Paris, and they anoptized the doctor, the physician, and they asked him a lot of questions. For example, when you enter, there was a door on your right. Was that door blocked? There was some object. There are a lot of detail at that. And the doctor answered. And because of that, they were able to attack the terrorists and to liberate all the people. So, you know, why? Because the doctor, when he was in the airport, he saw many things. But he was not conscious, aware of everything, and there is imagination. And under hypnosis, you were able to have the information. You know? So that proves that our imagination is storing a lot of information, and many of them we are not aware. And what is interesting, those information can come in our dreams. When we dream, they come. Okay? So, the necessity, okay, the role of, okay, at the bottom of page 4, the role in imagination, it is to store, first, to store impression, sensation, impression, sensible, impress, speeches, and also to use them, so to represent, to make present those images, impressions, and secondly, to use them, and that is the second part we'll see soon, fiction, creating from many things, we create a new thing. Okay. So next page, the role of imagination, conserving, storing, representation, reorganization. We take many things, but we reorganize that. That is the role, for example, of the cartoon, you know, the cartoons, the television. Jim and Jerry and
Tom and Jerry.
Or the Simpsons. I like the Simpsons. I scandalize children. I scandalize many Americans because I like the Simpsons. Because they have very, very good criticism of American life. Excellent. But we don't like to look at ourselves. But that is not only for American. You know, they are translated in 160 language. That movie, 160 language. I have in my room one of my nephew bought from a Chinese merchant the three first year of the Simpson in Chinese, in Thai, in many in the Asian language. You know, and you know in China they look at Simpson, they say, huh? They know that because in their village, in their town, there is a man like that, you know. It's universal. But what they do, they take an event of the family life or even of political life, and they make a program on that. So they start from the known to the unknown, if you want. It's the role of imagination. To be able to use what I know to my sensation and to put that in a new way. You see how they can think about that? With the power of imagination. All cartoons are based on Walt Disney. All that is based on imagination. And many, many fiction movies, all that is pure imagination. Imagination is very, very powerful, very important. So, fictionalization and reconstitution. For example, when the detective arrive on the spot of a crime, they have to reconstitute the crime. And they have to use their imagination. You are a cook, and you are called to prepare the meal for Thanksgiving or for an anniversary, then you have to use your imagination and to create new recipe, you know, to try to make new mixture. So what is the proper object and the formal object of imagination? You know, we come back to the same thing, proper and material. The material object first, the material or total object. It is what we see in totality. It all the image we have directly from our sense, our special senses, all those images. And that form and collated by coordinating senses. In fact, the matter of imagination, the total material object, are our sense images. Images known through our senses. But the formal object, it is the unique perspective or imagination, simply the image themselves, which do derive from, freed from all, that is important, freed from all attachment to the sensible world or concrete things. That means the image I have is no more attached to this. Of course, it will represent my dog, a puppy. But I can now, from puppy, from my dog Lonnie, I can create another kind of dog. I can imagine many things. So the imagination implies a kind of detachment. Detachment from the first image. Not only I can represent the image of puppy, but I can start from puppy and to create a novel about a dog who ran in the country, etc. That is imagination. Novels are based on imagination, but they don't start from nothing. They start from some sense experiences. I cannot make a history about a dog if I have no image of a dog, you know. I cannot write about an albatross or a condor if I have no image of what is a condor, you know. So that is, it is the starting point, to be freed from the, we can make image together a new way when we are detached from this object, this dog. It's a beginning of abstraction. It's not abstraction. Because the image I will do from my dog, Poppy, and creating a history of a dog, because Poppy never saved a child in the river. But in my imagination, I say, the dog, I give a new name, will save a child in the river. That is my invention, you know. But I can't do that because I'm no more attached to this dog called Poppy. But Poppy was the first cause of my knowledge what is a dog, as a form of a dog, you know. And freed from the experiences that originated them. That means there is no time in imagination. It is not the dog I saw when I visited my uncle, my grandfather, my grandmother. No, it is not a dog. Of course, he was inspired by Poppy. We say a dog. I give a new name, and that dog makes many things. I create a novel, you know. I create a movie with that. You know? Okay?
Your father?
Yes.
Just in imagination, we have the language of time. So for example, now I sit here and I imagine tomorrow I have an absent day, so I can go out, visit something, do something. So it's related to time at some places.
Yeah, it is related to some places, but it is not in the in time and space. You know, we don't situate the image you have is not situated in time. It's, for example, when I see Poppy, and I see my grandfather or my grandmother or my uncle hugging me, and the dog is is very happy, he's wagging his tail. That is memory. But I represent my dog Poppy and the dog of my uncle, and now I create a new dog. I imagine many other dogs with him. I create a history about dogs. That is imagination. I can use my imagination also to prepare the future. But that is another faculty, we'll see, it is the cogitative. Okay? Yes? Well. Now, the two main functions. The first function, it is storing, like we saw that, is the specific activity of imagination. Imagination, in fact, is atemporal or timeless. Imagination is atemporal. Atemporal. That means out of time, or timeless. And that is the specific making imagination different from memory. Memory is in the time. Imagination is not linked with time. When I refer my images to a specific event in the past, now it is memory. But when I don't refer to that, I think about dog, I think the image, or I think about the plane, the first time I was in a plane, you know. Well, of course, the memory, if they are very linked one to the other. But when I create a new image from, I don't create from memory, I create from my imagination. So the image is to represent, I told that to you, to make present what the image of the I saw in my past, but I don't take care of the past. It is not linked with the past. I put no date, no affective. No, it's only what I saw. You know, so the image stays in the imagination in absence of the object itself. It makes the object present to the mind through the image, phantasm, and the phantasm stays in me, and that phantasm is immaterial. It is a formal sign. His nature is only to indicate what is a dog, what is a cat. So, number seven, distinction between imagination and memory. The imagination act is timeless, atemporal. Okay? Memory is in time. We refer to before and after. Before I saw Poppy, and after I saw Poppy. You know? So that is time, you know. Now, a second, it is creativity, the power of creativity. That is wonderful. It is, I have more and more I think about imagination, I realize it is a so important sense in our life, very important sense. Even to pray, Saint Ignatius of Loyola use imagination. I say, represent and the same, see, smell the other. If you study Saint Ignatius of Loyola, he insists on senses. Here, for example, you have the fiction. Fiction, what is fiction? Is this to create a new situation from what we know before. I start from my dog Poppy, and I create new situation. I create a novel, like Harry Potter. Harry Potter is a pure imagination, but the people who are there, they are human, or they are, you know, we start from something. Okay. In fact, it is a reorganization of images. It's not a creation, strictly speaking. We reorganize. We organize in a new way. We say create, but this to create is to do something from nothing. But imagination does not anything from nothing. Start from our experiences, our images. Animals also have that. we share, we know the sense knowledge are also in the animal. They need, as in the coordinating sense to survive, they need imagination, you know? So they have imagination. They keep the images of some event of the person, for example. So we see that with cat and dog. Especially dogs will recognize it. And they can make a they have the, you know, they can have the image of they keep the image. We can imagine that when the dog is sleeping, maybe he is dreaming about a good meal. You know? They dream because their imagination also is working. It's not, imagination is common to animal and man. Okay? Because they have sensation. Because they have sensation, they have imagination.
So, imagination, that means it implies particular time and space. Sorry, memory. Mm-hmm. Memory needs time and space.
Yeah,
memory. But whereas the imagination...
Imagination is out of time and space.
Out of time and space.
Yeah. Imagination is not linked with... is the fruit of an event, but we don't refer to that event to have the image. You see the difference? In memory, I refer to the event to have the image. And the first time I saw Poppy, okay? But when I think about the dog and the image of the dog that comes to me is Poppy, that is imagination. I don't refer to the first time I saw it, okay? So animal. Animal cannot produce the creativity imagination, but they store. So they otherwise, if they were able to create something new, they would change. Bees will stop making the beehive the same manner, and spider also, you know. But they are the same. They can reproduce because they are, or they can have the image of something dangerous. They have the image. And when you see that, they immediately they react because they have the image, you know. For example, if when I have my dog, Noni, I told that to you, when he was not obedient, I used paper and I scratch on the floor with the paper. And the poor dog was suffering because his ears are very sensible. So when he saw me again with the paper, immediately he was on the floor waiting for the chastisement, you know, because he has the image. A dog can recognize as the image of the thing he saw before, you know, and he can make a link with even also. But my dog, for example, was able to see, and as soon as I had the newspaper in my hand, he was already suffering, because he knows what he was coming after, okay. So I come to the creative imaginative and act require conscious reflection. It is only realized through the influence of the intellective, the power of. So the intelligence is the cause of progress. If we progress, it is because we are intelligent. So the progress, it is the fact we can reflect on our experience, on our sensation. But the animal cannot reflect. So they reproduce perfectly the same situation, but they don't progress. Okay. You can read that by yourself. So I look to the square. Animal has no power of reflecting. So they can only represent what they sense. In the case of man, there is never pure creative imaginative act. That means man, all the time when he has imagination, he is linked with his reason. We cannot separate them, okay? Except if we smoke too much marijuana or LSD, or drink too much vodka. But normally, when we are sober, our imagination and our intellect, they are working together. My intellect is supervising my sensation. So the power of freely associating images, the power of association. So that is the creation of novel, the music. Imagine music with seven notes the musician can create million and million and millions of melodies because of the power of imagination. So you can read that here. Huh? The novel, the theater, huh? Etc. I go now to page. Yes, brother.
So what makes different the power of imagination between these people and another people?
Yes, we are, everyone has a different imagination. Why? We know we have the power, but we don't have the same experiences. Nobody has the same experiences as his brother. Even twin brothers in the family, they don't have the same experiences. Their imagination is not exactly the same.
So it means the more experience we have, the more imagination we have.
Exactly. Okay. And the more knowledge we can have. That is important. The more images you have, you acquire with awareness, the more you can have knowledge. Okay? Next page.
So yes. Everyone, when we see one object, is we have the same imagination?
We have the same object, but I think everything is received according to the disposition of the receiver. For example, I teach you now. If you are very attentive, you will receive my teaching not the same way that another who is thinking about what he saw yesterday in New York, or when he drank Polish beer, you know. That is important. When you preach in the parish, you have 400 people in the church, you have 400 different ways to listen to you. But you say only one thing, but the disposition are not exactly the same. One thing about his problem, another thing is thinking about the breakfast, he will add after the mass, etc. Okay? Imagination, you have the square here, for two functions. Go fiction, through art and technology. Art and technology. You have to add that here. Art and technology. In technology, the imagination is very, very important. Okay? We have that in the language, metaphor, comparison, analogy. All that are made. A large part of our theological knowledge is based on image. We step on God the Father, it's the image of the Father, no? We use continually images in to speak about immaterial reality. Okay? Metaphor, comparison, analogy, simile, simile is like that. He is furious like a lion. It is image. Literature is based on image, no? The beauty of a play, of a poem is the usage of images. Okay? We see, for example, the Queen of Beauty. You have that in your villages in Vietnam, maybe in America, the Queen of Beauty. Of course, sisters don't compete, because they will always win. Symphony of perfumes, etc. Okay, I go to page 8. The capacity of creating environment, art and technology. Art and technology. Painters use that a lot, imagination. The creative and imaginative act is not absolute creative act. Of course, we are not pure creator. We start from our experience and we create something new. We organize something new. The effect of fiction, it's important, huh? It is temporary relief. You need fiction sometimes, you know, to take a rest, beautiful, you think of music, you watch a beautiful movie, you read a novel. Page 9, so all human creation act is an act of discovery, and the human creative act is a constructionist nature. That means when we are taking a decision, when we are doing something, we start from something to go to a new thing. For example, your mother, when she is preparing a good meal, she uses what she knew before. She goes back to her past experience to do something, organize something new. something new. Okay. So we can read that. Huh? So every knowledge is from our sense experience. Every knowledge, we see that in the class, in two classes, every intelligent knowledge is attached to an image, a phantasm. Well, I prove that imagination is important. I can affirm with absolute certitude there is no absolute two identical room in the world. You can create a dormitory with a similar room. Go to Central. Is a room the same as another room? No. Creative power. You put a picture there. You put your bed there. You do that. You know, all the time. No. Okay. Even when you pray, do you pray exactly the same way? You use the same words. Do you use the same image? God is my fortress. Well, what is the image of fortress you have? God is my rock. What kind of rock, you see? You know?
Small rock.
Okay. This means, in short, that all human creation, in all act of discovery, is uncovering the previously unknown. When you discover something, you are uncovering what you had before. You cannot create without using the past. We are not God. So that is the power of imagination. So imagination creates a kind of freedom to sensation, so that they can organize in a different way from their acquisition. So we don't repeat exactly the same thing. We can modify what we know. Your mother told you, do that like that. But when you are in the kitchen, you say, no, I will try to do another way. No? And that is the progress, you know. And finally, is the imagination the source of error? Well, in fact, error is not imagination. Why? Because error is in the judgment. But imagination can induce somebody to make a wrong judgment. No? My imagination can transform some facts. Huh? It is a reason why it is difficult to have two witnesses, they see exactly the same thing. Because they did not see the same thing on the same point of view first. Secondly, they don't have the same imagination. So imagination is influencing a lot our life. And they can be inclining us to error, but error is not in the imagination, it is in the judgment. And what we see in the Gospel, in St. John yesterday also, don't trust appearances. My imagination starts from appearances, but my judgment must go farther than my imagination. Finally, truly, error is in the judgment, is not in the imagination. Imagination, of course, they would transform fact. You have a little fact at the beginning of the creation of the United States, and now that fact is amplified, you know. Legend, epics. In the history of countries or people, you have epics. That means they take a fact, but they amplify the fact, the imagination, you know. Is the reason why, for example, when there is an apparition of the Blessed Virgin Mary, you have to check if it is fiction or reality, no? Bernadette Subirus, when she said, I saw the Blessed Virgin Mary, Immaculate Conception, they have to check if it was a fiction image or it was a real apparition. I can, that is the danger of children. They see something, they say, oh, I saw that. Finally, it's not that. Like my dog with his tail on my door, you know? What is that? And imagination can produce, propose many things, many affirmations about a fact, but you have to check with your intellect, your reason. So dreams, of course, we have no power on dreams. And Plato used to say, the just man, the good man, do in dream what the wicked man do in reality. Okay, so we'll come back on dream when we study the unconscious. So prepare your next class about the memory.